Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back to the show. The Atheist Experience is live, July 20th, 2003. I'm your host, Martin Wagner, Ashley Perrien.
Afternoon.
My co-host, as always, thank you for joining us on this sweltering, blisteringly hot Sunday afternoon. We're very happy to have you. We've got 90 minutes of your usual freeform blasphemy and antics and hijinks to entertain you with until 6 p.m., so stay right here for it. This show is sponsored by Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. The ACA has weekly meetings every Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m. at Hot Jumbo Bagels, except for the first Sunday of each month, when we have our lecture series in the Mayor Room, excuse me, I almost went back in time there, the Mayor Room of the Austin History Center, which is located at 9th and Guadalupe. And Hot Jumbo Bagels is located at 307 West 5th Street, and that's downtown between Guadalupe and Lavaca. Okay, other ACA goings-on include Godless Gamers, which is every Monday night at 7 o'clock p.m. at Russell and Virginia Glasser's house, and ACA Happy Hour, which is a Thursday evening event. It starts about 7:30. People trickle in all evening long, though, so look for the little table with the Darwin fish on it. And that is at Antonio's Tex-Mex, which is near the intersection of Highway 183 and I-35. The Nonprofits is our biweekly internet radio show, which plays on the atheistnetwork.com website. It's an MP3 stream. The most recent episode was yesterday. And that's hosted by Jeff D., also Vic Farrow, Russell Glasser appear every week. The next episode will be two Saturdays from now, excuse me. And it's just 90 minutes of commentary on the news and what's going on in the world. A lot of fun to listen to, and there is an interactive chat room that, as I understand, the atheistnetwork.com website has changed to a different sort of chat room.
Okay.
It's more like, I think it's a JavaScript-enabled thing as opposed to like ICQ, what they used to have. And
okay.
So it's apparently they are having difficulties with it.
Okay.
But and if you miss any episodes of the Nonprofits, well, you can, of course, listen to about the last half dozen or so on our website on the radio show page. But that's Nonprofits biweekly on the internet. The University Atheists and Agnostics is a registered UT student organization. They are taking the summer off. But they are going to be starting their third semester coming up this fall. Had a very successful first year, and now I think it's they're going to be just shoring that up as the fall semester commences. If you are a UT student or faculty member, you're an atheist, well, this is the very first successful organization for folks like you that UT's had that I know of. And the right there on your monitor, uaa@mail.utexas.edu. is the email address to write to if you'd like information on the organization. And Charles Tabany, the founder of the group, will get back to you and let you know. As soon as we know where the meetings will be held starting in the fall semester, we'll tell you that too. But uaa.mail.utexas.edu for the University Atheists and Agnostics. Okay, I do believe that does it for the regular announcements. And once again, thanks for joining us. If you have never watched this show before, if this is the first time that you've ever surfed into us and tuned us in, we have been on the air, I guess, now for about 6 years. I think the show has been on about six
is
years.
Is it that long?
Well, I think the first episode with Ray Blevins and Joseph Zemecki was at the beginning of 97, so it's been 6.5 years.
Okay.
So it's been quite a while.
Wow, yeah.
And gone through many incarnations, and we're still here today. To answer your questions about atheism, if you want to talk about religious matters, what have you. We're the 90 minutes a week that provides the alternative to this flood of religious programming that is all over the cable waves. But if you want to call us up and you're a first-time viewer, keep in mind that our website has a FAQ page, Frequently Asked Questions, where we have assembled all of the most common questions that we get from Christians and our other religious viewers over the years, and we've just put up the answers right there. Just stuff like, you know, what is an atheist? What is atheism all about? You know, what do you believe? Oh, and this, that, and the other thing. What's the difference between being an atheist and an agnostic? Stuff like that. That's all on the website FAQ page, so you might want to check that out at the atheistcommunity.org/community.org website. And if we haven't answered your question, or if you have other questions than those, call us up. It's your show. And even though we do get quite a lot of phone calls every week, we never manage to get around to everybody. which is why we have started up, well, it's not all that new, it's been going for most of the year now, but viewer emails now. TV@atheist-community.org is your viewer feedback email address to send us letters. You want to ask us stuff, we respond to every email we get. The cool ones we'll read out on the air. But we print, I put up most of the good ones also on the viewer email pages on the website. We got a really interesting letter last week.
Yes.
From a guy, and I was going to bring it, and I forgot, but I don't think he was Mormon.
No, he sounded like he was writing, speaking of the Mormons.
Yeah, and just wanted to get our view on.
Yeah.
But he had a question pertaining to one of their doctrines, which is really very strange and certainly a big deviation from a Christian orthodoxy. Yeah. One of the things about Mormonism that is interesting, and we've actually brought this up on the show before when we've talked about Mormonism, and we had Paul Wilson on one time, who knows a thing or two about it. They have this belief that essentially when you die...
instead of heaven.
Yeah. You get your own... You get to be God, in a sense.
You get to have your own universe.
That's right.
So he spins off another universe just for you.
And so Elohim is the fellow who is our God.
Yes.
And apparently he is living off on some planet off somewhere.
Yeah.
And we pointed out, well, that's all very interesting. Now, but that seems to be very easy to confirm. Yeah. All the Mormons would need to do is tell us exactly where in the sky this planet is located.
Yeah.
We'll aim the Arecibo radio telescope at it. We'll start sending Hello God messages. But if we don't get anything back, what does that say? Which tells me, which is interesting that, they haven't undertaken that exercise yet. And the whole point was, in response to a discussion that we had had some time back pertaining to the power of religion and how it is able to hold this sort of power over people's imaginations. And I brought up the point that it has the power that it has over people because it is able to be this entirely supernatural, spiritual, metaphysical thing that is somehow above the mundane investigative procedures of science and stuff like that. And so as long as God remains to a certain degree unknowable,
To a very large part unknowable.
Then that is what enables the whole God meme, the whole God concept to continue to survive and thrive. Yeah. Because it's this thing that can be believed in on faith because, it is always to a certain degree untestable and unconfirmable. Yeah. And this emailer brought up this point. Well, this seems to be like a pretty concrete concept of God that could be tested. Yeah. Is it worthy of being taken more seriously because of that?
Yeah.
And you and I both kind of said, well, no, not really, until they actually do the test.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because saying God is actually a guy living on a planet somewhere, but then not telling us where the planet is so that we can send a probe or a radio beacon to it.
Yeah.
Then that planet's no better an idea than heaven.
Yeah.
Right?
But it would explain a couple of things, at least, possibly. If our guy Elohim is the god of our universe, and it turns out that he was a KFC manager in his world, that explains why we have problems in this universe and that things aren't perfect.
Issues with KFC management there,
but he could have been better. So.
Yeah, or maybe our God in his previous life was some sort of like TV network executive.
Exactly.
Which is why we get, he was like, our God was like, his universe is Jerry Bruckheimer, which is why we have the Gulf War and planes crashing into buildings and all of this stuff exploding, right? So, or something like that. But anyway, so.
It's the booth.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, hopefully you're not seeing that at home, folks. We were having some weird glitches on our monitor here in the studio. Okay, but that's announcements and that's emails. So TV@atheist-community.org for the viewer email feedback if you want to send us that. And it is time for Ashley to give us the news. We've babbled long enough. What's really happening in the world?
Okay, got a couple pieces of news, news here. Mm-hmm. And then one or two more stories that are more fun than a battle of monkeys.
okay.
First off, the Grand Canyon. They have some federal buildings up there which had some plaques on them. And these plaques had some quotes from the Book of Psalms on them. They had, O Lord, how manifold are thy works! In wisdom hast thou made them all, and earth is full of thy riches. Well, since those are on federal buildings, they have decided that that is not constitutional. Mm-hmm. And after more than 3 decades, they have been pulled down, and they are going to be returned to the people who donated them. which was the Evangelical Sisterhood of Mary in Phoenix. So they actually had it was a couple.
So they were in
three bronze plaques.
They were at a federal building.
Apparently, in the Grand Canyon.
In the Grand, like at the park, like was it part of the national park?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Well, then that's a good thing.
And so they said, yep, these are federal buildings. These are religious plaques on federal buildings, and that's not allowed based on the law, said Maureen Oltrog, a National Grand Canyon National Park spokesman.
And not everybody who comes to golf at the Grand Canyon is Christian.
Exactly.
And so that's, again, that's having there is this whole thing of, oh, not Christian? Then you're a second-class citizen here. Yeah. You know, can't have that. So they're giving them back to the donors.
The Evangelical Sisterhood of Mary in Phoenix.
And I'm sure they're crying and wailing. Is there going to be a countersuit?
They don't say anything here about anything that they're really going to do about it.
Put the plaques up, in their church
or in their private land.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Put the plaques up, where they can be put up, and the people who want to go see them and read them can do that, and that's all well and good.
And it's interesting that one of the plaques, the earth is full of thy riches. Well, if it's full of thy riches at the Grand Canyon, apparently God went back and took it back.
What?
So, gouged out.
Well, there's a big
swath of land. I'm taking my riches back.
Yes. Yes. You don't get those, whatever they were. Yes, I don't want you to have them after all. No.
Okay.
It's amazing.
Now, the next story in Kazakhstan.
Ah.
A distraught Kazakh mother kept her daughter's mummified corpse in her apartment for 3 years, hoping she would be resurrected by aliens. Olga, 27, was believed to have died from an autoimmune disorder after her mother failed or declined to call for medical help. We believe the death was from natural causes, although due to the long time that we had passed, we can't be absolutely sure.
How the hell did the body end up mummified?
Well,
unless she did it.
Vrema suggests the mother, a former nurse, could have known how to treat the body to preserve it.
Wait a minute. She's a former nurse.
Yes.
And yet she declined to get her daughter...
Well,
maybe that
failed or declined. Who knows what the situation? They don't say specifically.
Maybe they had an autoimmune disorder that she couldn't treat, and so in desperation.
Exactly.
But where do the aliens come in?
Trish said the mother appeared to have been influenced by a sect preaching cosmology that promised resurrection of her child with the help of a third cosmic eye or by aliens.
Wow. You know.
So she kept her mummified daughter's body. In the house for 3 years in the hope that aliens were going to come down and resurrect her.
Egad.
So,
I mean, you know, I know that it is the modus operandi of these sects to find vulnerable, emotionally distraught people and exploit them.
Yeah. And something like this, having your daughter die is definitely going to open up the door to, I mean,
well, sure,
strange things are going to happen when you're that upset.
Yeah. Well, yeah, so. I mean, look at like any tragedy. Okay, you see religion swoop in, right?
Exactly.
Columbine, okay, 9/11. I mean, religion is like there.
Yeah.
Well, you know, they're there just like, the, you know, the vultures just, you know, standing on the nearby cactus,
just
smacking their beaks.
Just waiting for the time.
Waiting for that old donkey to die. You know, that's just how cynical it is. But this is an extreme example.
Yeah.
As I've heard.
Yeah.
I mean, my golly.
So. Yep. So,
she mummified her, I guess, just so that she wouldn't stink up the place, but...
I assume so.
You know.
Try and keep the body relatively...
3 years, and it never... Yeah. The thought never crossed her little mind that, you know, maybe the aliens aren't gonna do this after all?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. She kept it there for 3 years. I think the mother is... said the mother was undergoing medical checks at a psychiatric clinic.
Well, that's good.
Her daughter's remains have been given a proper burial.
Wow.
Finally, after 3 years. So
just wow, you know, every time I think that there's nothing that can awe me anymore in terms of just the extremities to which irrationalism can take a person.
Sunday and the Atheist Experience rolls around.
I know, and there's something
wipes that idea completely out.
Don't.
We have not heard it all, people.
Well, great.
And speaking of hearing it all, Pat Robertson.
Our pal Pat.
He's back.
It's Pat. What's he up to? What's he been up to this week?
Religious broadcaster Pat Robertson urged his nationwide audience Monday to pray for God to remove three justices from the Supreme Court so they could be replaced by conservatives. We ask for miracles in regard to the Supreme Court, Robertson said on the Christian Broadcasting Network 700 Club. Robertson had launched a 21-day prayer offensive.
Okay, stop right there. why would it take 21 days for the word to get through to this supposedly all-powerful being? Yes. Is God just backed up, you know, and it has to go through his assistants?
They have bureaucracy in heaven.
Yeah, it must be. Okay. So it has to go through various ringers before it gets all the way.
They have red tape to cut through, just like everybody else.
Guess so. Okay. Onward.
A prayer offensive directed at the Supreme Court in the wake of its 6-3 June vote that decriminalized sodomy.
Okay.
The same letter targets three justices in particular. One justice is 83 years old. Another has cancer, and another has a heart condition. Would it not be possible for God to put in the minds of these three judges that it is time for them, that time has come for them to retire?
Okay, stop right there. Okay. What happened to Pat Robertson earlier this year?
One, he had health pancakes, and two, they didn't work, did they?
No, because what happened to him?
I think he had, like, some kind of cancer.
He was treated for colon cancer. For colon cancer. Now, it's benign, had it removed.
Well, guess where he's pulling all these stories out of.
Now, Pat comes down with colon cancer. He's 73.
Yes.
Why doesn't he take that as a sign from his God that it's time for him to retire? Apparently, being old and coming down with cancer is only a sign to retire if you happen to, like, not be a conservative fundamentalist Christian.
Yeah.
You know, who shares the views of Pat Robertson, apparently.
Yeah.
Onward.
And I do like it. He actually went on with CNN.
Uh-huh.
And had a fairly good interview with them.
Was this a Paula Zahn thing?
Yes.
Well, she's missed softball all the way. So, I mean, but...
Well, maybe more so, but every now and then she got something in there.
Right.
She was asking, do you understand why some people are offended, even though you're saying you're not telling your followers to pray for ill health for these three judges, that they could actually be interpreted that way?
See, that's a softball question. I would have asked him what I just asked. You had cancer earlier this year. Why isn't that a sign for you to retire?
Yeah.
You know?
Well, Robert said, well, they can interpret any way they want to. I'm talking to God, and it's up to him to make decision. And if some of these folks don't like what I'm praying for and want to pray the other way, have at it. Let the Lord decide.
So, of course, that's his out in the event that his prayer doesn't work.
In case anything, you know, whatever happens, it's the other people who are praying that got it.
Right.
So God still did what he was asked.
Yes, exactly. So this is how God gets to win every single time, even when you have something goofy like this.
Yeah. Yeah. Would it be in your judgment that your definition of prayer equally appropriate for you to pray for a change in the Constitution that wouldn't allow for a lifetime term in the benches? Which makes perfect sense. Right now, they're in there for the lifetime, if they want to be.
Mm-hmm.
So why can't he just pray for a change in the Constitution? Well, the possibility of getting a constitutional amendment of that magnitude through both houses of Congress and a 2/3 vote and then through 3/4 of the state legislatures is virtually impossible. I can't understand it.
Wait a minute! This God of his is supposed to be omnipotent!
Exactly. Who cares if Robertson can't understand it?
Yeah.
God should be able to. That should be petty work to get through.
See,
that.
This is not a hardball interview, right? Because he's just handing her stupid stuff, you know, that if she knew what she was doing, see...
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, there's a little bit of bubbling.
He was also interviewed by Katie Couric, and apparently he's like the one that is supposed to have a heart condition.
Okay.
Nobody knows who that is.
Really?
Yeah. Apparently none of the Supreme Court justices has a heart condition, apparently. That was like a goof on his part. Okay.
Wow.
Yeah.
Or maybe God knows something that nobody else...
Yeah, might be. Maybe there's like a blockage and they haven't, you know. So, you know, I love Pat. I think he's this wonderful man who is this great boon to atheism. You know, and they were talking yesterday on the radio show about, you know, just how they wish he'd shut up. I don't wish Pat Robertson would shut up. I love for him to keep talking. And because it isn't just that he makes a fool of himself, right?
Yeah.
It's that he redefines the concept of what it is to be foolish. In such a way...
He's always setting that bar a little bit higher.
It's like he's setting himself... He's the new paradigm, right? It's like, bet you can't top this one. So it's like he is the new role model. He's the template for foolishness of all, you know, in its
the one that
form.
All the fools in history look up to and say, my God, if I could only be like him.
I know. He's like, he's becoming a role model now. So... And it's just beautiful. And of course, what's great about it is that he is dragging Christian fundamentalism down with him.
Yeah.
You know, every time he opens his mouth and just some complete nonsense just spews out, right? You know, like undercooked spaghetti. It's just this beautiful sight, right? And I just love to watch him self-destruct over and over again. And he always gets media attention.
Yes.
Like this simply because the things he says are so outrageous and clownish.
Yeah.
But, you know, that wasn't the only dumb thing he said in the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, he's on a roll.
Yeah. For example, the other one is Liberia, right?
Yes.
Liberia is in turmoil right now, this little African country.
From my understanding, it's been in turmoil.
Yeah. They have had they've had a civil war going on for 10 years. It's killed 50,000 people. The president of Liberia, this fellow by the name of Charles Taylor, he seized power in 1989, apparently in a coup. But in 1997, they had an election, okay, where he was reelected. And I think the conventional wisdom is that this election was kind of bogus, sort of like they had an election in Iraq. And Saddam Hussein was the only guy on the ballot, so... Somehow that's just not a real election somehow, you know? It's just
Something's missing.
Yeah, they're not...
The second choice.
Not clear on the concept, but anyway. So, so there's been this civil war, and the UN, I guess, and people like us, right, we've been trying to negotiate the ceasefire agreement, civil war, and of course a condition for the ceasefire is requiring Charles Taylor to abdicate and leave.
Yes.
Leave the country, leave office. According to Amnesty International, Taylor's rule has been marked by such things. Here's the quote. It says, widespread, deliberate, and arbitrary killings of civilians, torture, including rape and dismemberment of limbs, abduction, and forced recruitment of large numbers of people, including children. But now what does Pat Robertson think of all this? Think of this guy, Charles Taylor? Well, he thinks he's a great guy.
Yeah.
Because Charles Taylor is a fellow Baptist.
Yes.
Okay. And the rebels...
And note the quotes there. Fellow Baptist.
Yeah.
He said that.
And the rebels, who they've been waging the civil war against, who are looking like they're getting the upper hand. I mean, it's this incredible scene going, like right now, as we speak, they're moving in. And, these are Muslim, largely.
Okay.
Right? But Pat Robertson has praised Taylor as a fellow Baptist. And this is what Robertson, like, here's his exact quote on what he had to say about this whole situation. He said, so we're undermining a Christian Baptist president to bring in Muslim rebels to take over the country. And here's the best part. And how dare the president of the United States say to the duly elected president of another country, you've got to step down. Pat, where were you on the Iraq war again?
Yeah.
You know, what was your position on that? So it's just amazing, right? Now, this could have something to do with the fact that old Pat has got an $8 million investment in Liberian gold mines.
Oh, come on.
Oh, you don't think so? That's just a pure coincidence, right?
Absolutely.
And, you know, the idea that a new regime might not honor his $8 million investment, that's just all...
He's purely spiritual. He's doing it out of the goodness of his heart for a fellow Christian.
Oh, well, I believe
that. The $8 million has absolutely nothing to do with it.
Well, you've convinced me completely. So anyway... So, all right, but there's old Pat, so, you know. If he didn't exist, we'd have to invent him, I tell you. I love Pat Robertson. I'm thinking about starting up, like, some internet, you know, group. Like Atheists for Pat. Go Pat, you know?
Yeah. Wow.
Pat's our pal. Our pal Pat. So.
Okay.
Well, stop me before I alliterate again. What's
okay,
more
next
on
one.
News?
We had a story similar to this a couple months back.
Okay.
But... these people just keep cropping up, and it's fun when they do.
Okay.
For some people. A New Mexico family is suing its local Catholic church over a funeral mass at which the priest allegedly said the relative was going straight to hell. The family of Ben Martinez, 80, alleged that Reverend Scott Mansfield said that he was living in sin, lukewarm in his faith, and that, now get this, the Lord vomited people like Ben out of his mouth to hell. Around 200 people attended the funeral. 9 members of the Martinez families are seeking punitive and compensatory damages for severe emotional and physical suffering by telling that their dear Uncle Ben, or whatever,
God would have vomited him forth into hell.
Vomited he people him to hell. The imagery there is wonderful.
Yeah.
Let's see. Yeah, one of the plaintiffs allegedly said...
The looks on faces, I'm seeing them.
I know. I know.
Boy.
Aghast.
Yeah.
One of the plaintiffs allegedly said that people...
Does this guy owe this priest money or something?
Said people in the town are staring at her, thinking her father is in hell. The complaint also said...
Wait.
Yeah, I know.
The people in the town, apparently, according to her, are believing this.
Okay, the people in the town aren't thinking, boy, that priest was a real a-hole for saying that. They're thinking...
They're siding with the priest and saying, my God, your father's in hell.
Yikes.
So,
I tell you.
The complaints also said that the father Mansfield walked to the grave. He laced his comments about Mr. Martinez with profanities.
Wow!
So... he had some choice words for old Ben, and apparently nobody else appreciated them.
Old Ben was a ne'er-do-well, I guess.
Now, if they're suing...
I thought this was in the country of Mexico, but it was in New Mexico, so I'm misremembering that then.
Okay. Now, it is interesting. They're suing them for emotional and physical suffering.
Yeah.
I'm really mixed about that on whether or not they should win or, you know, whether the Catholic Church should win or lose. Now,
I mean, the church.
The church.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, it was clearly like a kind of a tactless thing to do, don't you think?
Apparently. Well, yes, it was.
I mean, but just like, I mean, Fred Phelps shows up at the funerals of gay people with, you know.
Yeah.
But signs.
But
and
that was
signs.
That was. Nobody asked him to come.
Well, a tactless remark at a funeral is still tactless whether you ask the guy to come or not, right? I mean, whether it's the guy priest officiating.
True, but I mean, if you hire...
Like, it's even worse if
you hire the priest to say this.
Then it's even worse if you hire some guy that you expect to deliver eulogy, you know, and he's like, you know, you're in hell now, mother, you know, you know, God vomited you up.
Maybe
that's even worse. That's like a betrayal, you know, it's like he...
Maybe they should find a way to test it. If he's right, then they win. If he's wrong, then they lose. Now, how are they going to prove whether or not Ben is in hell or not?
Call Sylvia Brown.
Still working on that one. But,
John Edward. That's it.
But yeah, if he's in hell, then, you know, sorry.
Well, it will be an interesting lawsuit. It'll be interesting
to see what happens with that one.
Transpires. Yeah.
So. Wow. Open mouth, insert foot.
Yeah. Well, clearly it was just like crude and impolite. I mean, I know the old guy was a complete SOB. Yeah. But
and at least they're suing him here. What happened in the previous story, and I think this is about 6 months ago or so, it was a very, very similar thing to where the preacher had said the same kind of things, and the people at the funeral actually got up, dragged him out, and beat the snot out of him.
Well,
so,
as long as the people there didn't probably want to do that, but... You know. They exercised a bit of restraint. Well, they're probably just in such total shock and awe.
I know that.
Yeah, they're in disbelief that they were.
Yeah, it was an hour later that they said, oh my God.
Yeah, it took that long to sink in. It was thing to say.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. So. Well, we're going to put that phone number up on the screen. We had it up, but we want to get it back up yet again to start taking phone calls. 477-2288 is that number to call us up and give us a piece of your mind. So let us know what you have to say about insulting priests at funerals or anything
insulting
else.
Insulting priest Pat Robertson.
Talk about.
It's all living again.
Yeah, and yeah, good old Pat. Let's have some. Let's have a fun with Pat show today or something. I don't know. Oh, look, it's someone we know on line one. It's Russell.
Hi there.
How you doing?
I just wanted to mention something I put up for the radio show yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
When I originally saw that story about Pat Robertson praying on CNN, he had this really weird expression where his eyes were all squint shut.
Yes.
And he looked just like Eric Cartman from South Park. So yeah. I went and hunted down a similar looking picture.
Oh, cool.
Of and I put it up on my website.
Okay. Is this the tiny URL version of it?
Yeah.
That's kind of almost obscene, but it's fitting, isn't it?
Yeah, it looks like that. It's completely random. I didn't pick that URL.
Yeah, this was not intelligent design, folks. It just randomly worked out that way. But
right.
This is where you can view,
Just old go Pat to that, and it's a link to my webpage and a picture of them side by side so you can do the comparison.
It's beautiful, yeah.
Did you guys see that already?
I've seen it, yeah.
I've seen the picture. I haven't seen that. But
you know, speaking of, I downloaded the MP3 of yesterday's show.
Yes?
And it's like, it's not the full show. It's like it's 40 minutes.
Oh, well, I better fix that. Thanks for mentioning it.
Yeah, wow. It might have been a problem with my download, but I've never had that happen before, so.
Okay.
Anyway, well, thanks for calling.
letting us know that.
Have fun. Bye.
Okay. Well, there you are. If you want to go to tinyurl.com/... say it yourself. That's the web address to view Pat Robertson and his constipated pal Eric Cartman. And so we're gonna let the phone calls continue to rack up. And what's your other piece of news we got going?
Okay, we got one more here. That was a little bit off. This was an athlete, Deion Sanders.
Yeah, old Dallas Cowboy guy.
Yep.
Yeah.
He actually won a case. There was a lawsuit filed by Magrethia Incorporated, a vintage car restoration business, said former Dallas Cowboy cornerback refused to pay a $4,000 car repair bill because Jesus had informed him that $1,500 was all he had to pay. Apparently, he had an old car that he wanted to get restored, so he brought it in and said, fix it. They came back to him and said, okay, here's, you know, $4,200, please. And he is now saying after the fact, according to the company, he's saying after the fact that he had put a cap on it at $1,500. He doesn't want to pay any more than that, and that's all he has to do. He was also saying that they were trying to rip him off, essentially, because he's a big star and he's a big athlete and stuff like that. They're just going to inflate costs and try and you know, pull whatever they can out of him. What they did was replace the battery, the starter motor, radiator, and thermostat. They flushed out the engine blocks, electrical system, various gauges, removed contaminated fuel, rebuilt the carburetor, replaced gaskets and hoses. So it sounds like
all they just did
in a work.
They rebuilt the car.
Yeah, I mean,
pretty much.
It sounds like a fair bit of work.
Yeah.
He basically said,
you know, I'm not a big athlete.
$1,500 is all in his heart. It is all he had to pay.
So is that working out for him then, or the?
Apparently, yes, he won. Yes, they ruled in favor of him that he only has to pay $1,500.
How? What was the court's opinion?
Yep, I don't have it here.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, he just
did. The court actually think? Why? Yes, in fact, Jesus Christ did speak to Deion Sanders.
Well, apparently, I would think that they're probably not calling on Jesus on the stand. They probably assume that, you know, given the amount of work, $1,500 may be more of an actual inline price than $4,200.
Well, no, it's not.
Given that it was a big star,
you just do your transmission. That's $1,500 right there.
Is it?
At least.
I have no idea.
Yeah. I had to get my transmission completely rebuilt. And that's, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Radiator will run you like $700-$800.
Yeah. Replace the car's battery, starter motor, radiator, and thermostat.
Yeah. Radiator right there would be, well.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, apparently.
Did they like try to hit him up for what? Like, what did they really try to?
They charged him $4,265.
That's just
$1,200.
Well, the argument that Jesus died, that's just stupid. But I mean, what is he whining about? He's a millionaire football player. That's pocket money for him, and that's just kind of
true.
Stupid.
But I can understand the point that if you honest now, like say for something like this, I don't know what actually should be charged.
Hmm.
But I mean, seriously,
yeah,
somebody
don't say Jesus told me that I only had to pay $1,500. What you do is you call around, you get estimates from like 18 other places,
and obviously he's denying that he ever said anything about Jesus.
Oh, Deion Sanders isn't saying that he said that. It's
exactly.
The car place.
It's the car
saying,
mechanic that's saying, you know.
He said that Jesus
Deion
said.
Yeah, Deion Sanders came in here and said, can you get a Jesus discount? So, and they actually use that term, Jesus discount.
So, don't get a Jesus discount at that place, gang.
So yeah, I mean, apparently it's a lot of mix-ups over who said what.
Hmm.
And apparently they ruled for him.
Wow, okay.
So, it'd be interesting to be in that courtroom and see what happened, but hey.
Okay.
So.
Oh, wow. Okay, well, I guess that's it. The phone calls, I guess, are everyone's outside enjoying the heat or something like that today. But there it is, 477-2288, if you want to call us up and yell at us. We will, in the interim... did I bring this up already, the Roy Moore thing, the old business? I didn't, did I?
No.
Okay, good. Well, then let's talk a little bit of old business from last week's show. We had a caller bring up... a whole slew of political topics, and was essentially taking us to task for being as harsh as we were, I guess, to conservative politicians.
Okay.
And his whole argument seemed to be that, you know,
Oh.
Yeah, they never get anything. You know, there must be this wonderful system of checks and balances, and the extremists never get anything pulled through anyway. So why
are
you?
Who cares?
Yeah, exactly. He sort of seemed to have the gist of his argument was this whole "who cares" attitude. Yeah. And of course, you gotta care, right? Because the reason that the extremists don't get more stuff passed in there is because people stand up to them.
Yeah.
You know, it's not the system of checks and balances that we have isn't this thing that is on autopilot.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we have to make it.
It requires people complaining.
Exactly. But at one point in the discussion, he did challenge me for some information. We were talking about Roy Moore and Roy's affiliation with the religious right. Roy Moore is the Chief Justice of the Alabama Supreme Court.
Yeah.
And he's been all over the news about this, like, 5-ton massive Ten Commandments display.
Yeah, I think it's a 2.5-ton block of granite. Something.
That's it. Like 2.5 tons. Big thing, right?
Yeah.
Slipped it in the dark of night. And it's been there. And he has steadfastly refused to take it down. Appellate court has now said that he has to, but he's being defiant all the way up to the Supreme Court. He says he's going to take it to the Supreme Court of the United States, which, given their slightly more progressive leanings of late, you know, he may be in for a rude awakening. You know, couple that with the fact that there's all sorts of precedent, right? Legal, there's Ten Commandments monuments are coming down all over the place.
Left and right,
There was a thing where Roy Moore, a case in which Roy Moore awarded custody of a child. There was a child custody battle.
Yes.
And he awarded the child the custody to the father of the child, even though the father had a track record of abuse.
Yeah.
The mother had left the father and had begun a lesbian relationship and had moved out to California. And Roy Moore found in favor of the father solely on the basis of the fact that the mother was now gay.
Yeah.
And he said that. And he said, this is my reasoning. You know, I think that homosexuality is morally wrong and yada, yada,
Who cares that the guy was a convicted child molester?
Yeah. I don't think it was that extreme. Maybe he wasn't a convicted child molester, but there had been domestics involved with him, right? But the caller in question challenged me. It's like, when was that tried? And I told him I'd look it up, and I did. That was February 2002, so it was pretty recent.
Yeah.
February 2002, so it was when he was the Chief Justice. So this is the thing that was already, you know, his qualifications for being in charge of the highest court in Alabama were being cast, doubt was being cast on his ability to be fair, which clearly he wasn't, because he was being openly homophobic and not caring, right? And he was basing all of this upon his, you know, fundamentalist religious nonsense, right?
Yeah.
Now, it appears that there are more ties now with, like, the state of Alabama and the government there and the strange arch-conservative fringe religious groups. It's come out. This was in a news article some time back, and I read this also on the American Atheist website, that there's a group of white supremacist secessionists. I mean, this is about as far as you get, right? They're called the League of the South.
Okay. Yeah.
And their leader has been quoted publicly as calling slavery a God-ordained institution, stuff like that. Okay, they've been allowed to hold meetings in state buildings.
Wow.
Yeah. I have a feeling that if, you know, Larry Darby and the, you know, Alabama, you know,
what was it? They tried to have that every year. Mm-hmm. I think it was in Alabama. We had it a couple weeks back. They had some kind of thing where it was a gay and lesbian shindig of some kind. I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was held in one of the federal buildings.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think it was more. No, this was Ashcroft. This was Ashcroft.
That's it. Yeah.
Yeah, and Ashcroft came and said
it was a 5-week thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the president hasn't approved it, and they go, well, you know, the president doesn't have to approve it, and he goes, well, according to new rules, yeah, he does.
Yeah.
According to these, where is that written down?
These new rules. Yeah. Here. Here.
And so it was one of these weird things like that. So, yeah, I mean,
apparently these Ashcroft's a creep.
Strange people are getting in the power. So, that's why we have to.
It's because the Bush administration is the most, arch conservative to the point of, like, you know, promoting intolerance.
Yeah.
You know, administration that we have had in a long time.
Yeah.
I mean, we had jingoism going on in the Reagan years and in the Eisenhower and what have you, right? But it seems like it has reached an unprecedented level with the George W. Bush administration, where any criticism of Bush and his policies is interpreted as something not terribly far from treason.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And this whole sort of attempting to stifle any kind of dissent or debate, which is patently un-American.
Yeah.
And getting so bad that I read an article on salon.com saying that there's some people are getting fed up. Like there are some folks, some Americans who are contemplating just moving to Toronto or Vancouver or like emigrating to Canada just because the climate in America is just becoming too conservative, conservative to the point of just purely being intolerant and insufferable.
Wow.
And that's a shame. I mean, I think people should stay here and fight, you know, for what's
exactly.
right.
Exactly. Argue and yell and make their points heard.
Yeah. And of course, it's not just that this is an arch-conservative administration. I can imagine how a flamboyantly liberal administration that, you know, you could still have ideologues and demagogues and extremists there.
Yeah.
You know, stifling. We had something very much like that in the 90s with this whole idea of political correctness.
Yeah.
You know, where political correctness
don't offend anybody.
That's right. It was you cannot say anything that could possibly offend any, you know, minority group of any kind.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if you do, you have to sort of be punished and shouted down for it. But interestingly enough, you know, the rules of political correctness only seem to apply to white males.
Yeah.
You know, straight white males.
Yeah.
And, you know, but anybody else, you know, anybody else could say anything about straight white males they wanted to. But so that was like, you know, stifling of dissent from the far left.
Yeah.
And now we've kind of got it from the far right. So. Yeah. Okay, we're starting to get the calls lined up. Everyone's kind of slow today. Come on, what's up? Or, you know, you must have something to... we must be saying something that's making you mad. So, and if we're not, we'll say more things to make you mad. But we're going to get the calls lined up
taunt
here.
Us.
But it's your show for live call-in, so let's see what Robbie has to say. Hey, you're on TV.
Martin, if you listened to the radio yesterday, there was an article, a news article about the GIs in Iraq defending against the president said that they were...
Yes.
They had come out against it, been on the news and everything,
yeah.
And they said they was going to discipline them. I think it was Ashcroft or Rumsfeld.
I think it was Rumsfeld, yeah.
Yeah, he said that they was going to discipline them because they don't have the right to do that.
Yeah. Now, this is one of those interesting stories, actually. I didn't read over the entire article. So I don't know the whole story. Maybe you can fill me in on the details here. But essentially, if there are military personnel overseas,
mm-hmm.
and they are speaking to other military personnel overseas, dissent is a really scary thing to be getting too much about. One, it's strengthening the enemy. The enemy is going to hear that they're going to say, aha, look, even the people that are attacking us are getting pissed off and don't want to do this. And then the Americans over there are just getting more riled up and saying, yeah, you know, it really sucks. We've been here 6 months. This bites.
You know? But I mean, but why is that? Why? It's because the Bush administration has not given these guys any clue as to like when they're going to get some leave, when they might be coming home, how long this whole
The situation could definitely be better.
And they've now there's guerrilla warfare going on. These guys are being pot shot at random now.
Yeah.
We have servicemen dying every day. From snipers and from people just walking up to them at random and pulling out pistols and capping them, you know, and it's morale is gonna deflate, especially if they don't get any what seems to be apparent support from home.
Well, here, you know? let me explain something to you. Yeah. I'm retired military,
right?
And when we were in Vietnam and when we were in Korea, they said you do a year, you're coming home.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. These guys have been there, haven't been told how long they're going to be there. They've been there a long time. They was told that different stories each time they asked how soon are we going home.
Yeah.
Now they're telling another story. You might not come home for 18 months. You might not come home for a year.
Yeah.
And there is no consistency from the top commanders.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
haven't some of them had leaves postponed like two or three times already?
That's right.
Yeah.
And I don't blame them. Now, we had bitching in Vietnam.
Well, every soldier grunts.
Yeah. And they went to the news people, uh-huh. and they told them, and it blasted out over the news.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's a slightly different situation. We have an all-volunteer military now.
That's right.
In the Vietnam, you had the draft. Maybe the implication is that if you enlisted for this, you got to take your medicine and
I enlisted for 30 years, and they I bitched.
Yeah. Well, what were there serious reprisals from on high if
no.
you know, the enlisted men?
No.
Yeah,
really?
We're like, we don't want to be here running around in the jungles breathing in.
I was an officer, and no, we didn't.
Yeah.
We didn't do anything.
Yeah.
Okay. Because I've heard that I'm not in the military, obviously, but I've heard that they usually do have, it is pretty serious if you're speaking out heavily against what you're doing there.
Right.
Just, again, for morale issues and stuff like that, you don't want to be making it any worse than it already is.
Right.
Now, again, could this have been handled better?
Yeah.
Of course. Mm. But do we, you know, want to then throw a match into the oily rags? So,
well, I think that George kind of did that when he came on television and talked to the enemy.
Yeah.
And said, bring them on. And ever since then, they've been bringing it on, where we've had at least one serviceman or woman, you know, killed today.
The Senate and the Congress and the President or nobody, his staff, has got any kids in Iraq.
Well, yeah. Sure, yeah. And it's...
And yeah, I know it's volunteer, but still,
Well, I think that, you know, clearly the whole thing is, you know, just falling apart more and more. I mean, the signs of abject failure over there.
I still think he wants to become the first American Caesar.
Well, he wouldn't be the first to want that. You know,
yeah.
I'll give him that much.
Look at Eisenhower. Yeah.
Well,
okay, thank you.
Well, thanks for your input.
Thanks, Paul.
Yeah. Still, yeah, it's a messy situation there. There's an unconfirmed report, and we stress that it's unconfirmed. It's coming from the meeting in, I think, Aqaba. When Bush met with the Palestinian prime minister and with Ariel Sharon, and they were trying to set up the roadmap for peace over there. And a Palestinian newspaper reported, and this is completely unconfirmed, that you know, Bush told the other leaders in that area that you know, he went into Iraq because he thought God told him to.
Yeah.
He said, you know, I asked God.
God told me to get Iraq, and I did.
Yeah, and... And that is, you know, if it's true, it is really, really kind of disturbing. It's not disturbing. I mean, look, anybody, including the president, has the right to his own beliefs and what have you. But, you know, our history, you know, the history of our world is filled with, you know, terrible disasters that happened because, you know, people thought that God was talking to them.
Yeah.
And God said, do this thing and you will be one of my chosen and elect.
Yeah.
And to hear that coming from, you know, the leader of today you expect to hear it come from like fanatical terrorist groups,
exactly,
and Operation Rescue, and all kinds
to
of
hear
backups
Saddam
like
Hussein
that.
Hussein say that? Okay,
yeah.
Fine.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, you expect it from somebody on the fringe,
but
to hear it come from like, you know, the leader of, you know, what is still for the time being the most powerful nation in the world, is. But again,
now,
we stress it's unconfirmed. Though.
Exactly,
we don't know he said.
Part
that.
Of the problem with that was that. It was translated like from Arabic into, you know, it was translated like it was translation of a translation of a translation of a translation type thing.
Mm-hmm.
It had to go down the chain. And in some of those languages, having God in the speech is just a dialect almost. It's just how it's a mannerism in language to have God in there every other word. And so it is possible that like, say, how this was translated and brought down the chain is how that happened.
Hmm.
We don't know.
Yeah.
So, like, say, I mean, it's unconfirmed.
Yeah, whether he said it or not, I mean, it's not like it's any big secret that Bush is in bed with the religious right.
Of course,
right.
Of course.
You know, I mean, he's constantly seen.
He's a religious fanatic.
Yeah, yeah, we know this. He's made a, you know, right on the campaign trail, he said, my favorite political philosopher is Jesus, which is kind of bizarre, right? Because, you know, Jesus is this anti-family communist.
I know.
In some ways.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thought of.
Yeah.
But
if you love me, you must hate your family.
You know, sort of. You
have to leave your mother.
Give away all your possessions.
Yeah, yeah,
and
that
sort of thing. So, but yeah, so it's not like this is a news big news flash that Bush is is
funny,
all
wacko.
Close to being extremist in his religious views. But I don't know. Still, you know. Should
potential to scare.
Yeah. Well, let's see what Ryan is on the phone. Let's see what he has to say about all this. Hey, you're on TV.
I was just going to tell y'all that there's a lot of evidence out there to support the fact that George Bush really isn't a Christian. He's actually practices a a Luciferian religion, and he's a member of an order called the Skull and Bones.
Ah, yeah, I've heard of that. They have that thing out some kind of canyon lake or whatever and sacrifice babies in the fire,
Yeah, I don't know if it's anything that... Skull and Bones, it's one of these secret societies
that like he had at
Yale.
It was.
Yeah, Bush is a Yalie. And, yeah, I've heard tales about that. We actually had a caller bring this up a few shows ago and ask us, like, you know, what we thought about the possible demonic significance of this and whether or not, you know, the Christianity thing on Bush's behalf is all a big fraud and what have you. Personally, I don't care. I think one way or another, it's a big kooky belief. But I think that a lot of what goes on with these college secret societies, especially when you have, you know, these Ivy League schools where you have the sons of the rich and the powerful going there, I think that it's just like a big frat. These guys, and they join this thing, and it's secret, and it's cool, and it's a way that they can, you know, think of themselves as, we're the elect, and we're apart from the rest of the student body and the masses and what have you.
We are in our own little club, and we are powerful.
And if it does, in fact, turn out that they have some sort of Luciferian thing going on, I would think that that would be just as silly as any kind of, you know, fundamentalist far-right-wing Christianity. So, yeah, I mean, it may happen, and I would be certainly very interested to know if he really does do that kind of thing. So.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Okay, Take care. Okay.
Yeah, but any evidence that he's actually sacrificing babies, that we should know about.
I think that's a bit iffy. There was the Bohemian Grove thing.
Yeah, that was it.
You know, who knows? I mean, I'm sure it wasn't anything quite like that, but it was, it does seem to be the sort of thing that you can work people up into a weird frenzy about. And one guy was worked up.
Yeah.
I happen to have the article right here.
Oh, wow.
From back in the day. Here we are. this guy. This is from a year ago, May. The fellow, the self-styled commando who invaded the Bohemian Grove in January, was sentenced in May of 2002 to almost 12 years in prison. Anyway, he heard this report. I won't mention the name of the show, but we can all pretty much guess maybe who, or, you know, if you've been around the block a bit here in town, you might guess where he heard that. But this guy was inspired to pick up rifles and dress in this superhero costume and go out to the Bohemian Grove where he was going to, like, you know, take some people out because he thought that there was a blurry video, which I've seen, and it's this big blurry video, and the maker of the blurry video claims that there was human sacrifice being made. And so this guy went out there basically to do murder.
Yeah.
So, which says a thing about, you know, irresponsibility of certain reportage. But, you know, fortunately, he was inept and stupid enough to just sort of, like, make a fool of himself.
Yeah. I think the gardener got him.
I do believe you're right. Yeah. He was wearing a bulletproof vest. His name is Richard McCaslin. A skull mask and a commando-style uniform with the name Phantom Patriot sewn on it. Then he sneaked inside, stayed overnight, started two small fires in empty buildings. And then McCaslin, when approached, was said he was looking for satanic cultists, but found only a caretaker and a security guard. And probably a few possums and what have you. So the possums weren't talking. So, anyway, but boy, that's just, you know, I'm glad that not all of our most potentially dangerous citizens are complete goofballs, but it's always comforting when some of them are. You know, because we kind of, okay, Tony's online too. Maybe he has something to say about all this. Hey, you're on the air.
Yeah, I just wanted to say real quick about that. You said about that supremacist group having a meeting in a state building. I'm very glad you said that because that's truth. That's honest truth.
Yeah.
I truly believe that. And
you mean this the racist group?
Right. I really believe that's happening. I'm glad you brought that up.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's a dirty little secret that they don't want to, you know, let out.
Right. And the thing about it is, what people might not know is they've been financially supported by. You know, people may have in power position, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people might not want to say it, but some of those groups are being financial supported.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one thing that I would like to see happen, because that's good and bad in all races, you know, that's good and even all race, you know, but I would just wish that, you know, if their parents wouldn't raise their kids to be like that, you know, I think that would make a difference, you know, maybe lead us all in the right direction.
Yeah.
Sure.
Know? But, you know, history will tell you that. In reality, a lot of the hate crimes have been committed against the black race, though. You know, that's just, you know, being real with it. But one thing I would like to see change is that the parents raise their kids not to be hatred, not to be racist. And maybe 20, 30, 40 years from now, maybe, you know, we'll be in a better position than where we are now.
Yeah.
But, you know, if their parents not willing to make a difference, then, you know, we're going to be, you know, the same thing 20, 50 years from now.
Yeah, and, you know, it is a shame that we still have so far to go with this, apparently.
Absolutely. And it's really a shame that, you know.
And you know.
A long time.
Yeah, and of course, we don't lay all the blame for this at religion's feet either. Okay.
Right.
I mean,
right.
You know, most Christians are appalled by, you know, racism as anybody else. But it is telling that religion does seem to be this kind of thing that you can take to an extreme to justify hate.
Right.
And people do that. They do it against blacks, against Jews, against gays. You always do tend to see a fanatical religious element at the root of these things. I mean, I think that it, you know, why is it that most of the white supremacist groups in this country have names like World Church of the Creator and Christian Identity?
Yeah.
Now, and even say, and I know, you know, nice religious people are going to say, oh, but they're perverting the whole idea of what that's supposed to be. And sure, that's fine. But I think that people really need to look carefully at, you know, the when you have belief systems that aren't rational and that are open to any sort of wild interpretation, where you can say, God spoke to me today and he said that I should burn down this black church because they're actually evil and they shouldn't be doing this stuff. Yeah, I think people really need to question the influence of fanaticism and religious fanaticism in all of this and stand up to that too.
Right.
You know, it's not so.
And you know, then again, I really personally, I don't have nothing against no one religious. That's what they want to believe in. But I just think it's so many of them fake. You know, they just fake. They send so many mixed signals. They about phoned in a $3 bill.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, can't do that. I'm just being true. I don't care if they get mad or not, but so many of them, they are so phony.
Yeah.
Man, don't even, it's hard to believe the hype.
Yeah.
You know, it really is. And they come tell you one thing, and then you go see it something else.
Yeah.
You know, you made an interesting point a time back that a lot of churches is just business. You know, and it really is business.
Yeah.
And then, you know, if you tell them that, then they get upset. You know, one arguing against the other. Somebody go to this church, they arguing against the other church. They all competing against one another. See who can get the biggest building, who can get the largest congregation,
that's exactly right.
Who
can
get the most money.
You know what it's called? It's called the prosperity gospel. This whole idea that you pay into the church and you get your blessings in return.
Yeah.
It's basically this. It's no different than what the Catholic Church was doing back in the medieval days. They, in the Middle Ages, the Catholic Church in the Vatican would do this thing called selling indulgences, papal indulgences, and they would sell these. Like, you would go to the Vatican, and you would give the Pope or his lackeys a big bag of gold, right? And you would get a thing saying, you're going to heaven now. I mean, seriously, that's what they did.
Wow.
And it's like this prosperity gospel that you see in Christian fundamentalism is pretty much the same deal. It's you pay in, and you get your blessings. You get it's all the way they're interpreting the whole you reap what you sow thing.
And I have a hard time believing that God is if there actually was a God, he's in heaven saying, well, you only gave me $35, dude. Yeah. What do you expect me to do? Come on.
He's all powerful. What do you need money for?
What do you need money for? Yeah.
What's
going to do with $35?
Well, let's just get ready. Let's go. I will say that, you know, some people, they go to church Sunday, but Monday through Saturday, man, they so evil. They doing all their crooks. Now, how are you supposed to believe that? You know, it's the truth, though. How can a person really believe them?
Yeah.
You know what they do?
They're going to play the good Christians.
Yeah.
And all the rest of the days, here they are today, no good dirt.
That's right. They do that, and then that's the way they really live, and then they go to Sunday to church to feel better about themselves.
Exactly.
It's like their weekly,
they're cleansing.
Yeah. Well, we appreciate your calling. Some good points, man. Take care.
Thanks for calling.
Okay.
Yeah, they by going to church, they've done their good deed. That'll support me through the rest of the week now.
Yeah.
So I can get, you know, I can have a good old time now.
Well, if you got something to say on that, folks, call us up. Yeah. Let us know. The calls have been kind of intermittent today. It's been a little surprise. We're usually backed up. We're lit like a Christmas tree. I guess,
But when you start getting into that, this whole racism thing, unfortunately, what a lot of these groups do is the one that we were talking about earlier, they're not saying, you know, ha, 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 we're racist and we want to hold meetings. they're pitching it as, you know, we are a religious organization. We are, you know, a conservative religious group, and so we would like to have time in your buildings. And it's just kind of common sense. You know what their history is. You know what they're doing. You know, the KKK is not a religious organization. You know, they're not just trying to make sure that you get good conservative people in there. It's
they trot out a lot of religious rhetoric and dialogue, in their speeches.
Yeah.
You know, and in their rallies and in what have you.
Yeah. And they're, they're obviously trying to change the face of it, I think.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, that's
how
just
true it is. I'd question it.
Well, you know, I mean, it is the danger that comes with the whole territory of irrational beliefs, right?
Yeah.
You know, if you believe that your best friend is the invisible creator of the universe,
yeah,
okay, and that you're in tight with him, yeah, well, then you can
do anything you want.
Right, justify just about anything.
Yeah. And okay, given that the Bible is just so chock full of every opinion under the sun and then a few.
The big book of multiple choice.
Exactly. You can support absolutely any view.
Yeah.
And no group can say you're wrong, because you can find, you know, five or six Bible verses that will back you up wholeheartedly.
Yeah.
Now, they can also find five or six to back them up. So
yeah, but that's the thing, right?
But
find scripture to back anything up.
So yeah,
it's interesting. Been reading some other old religious texts lately. things like the Gnostic texts, the Gnostic scriptures, the Nag Hammadi manuscripts, things like this.
Yeah,
the Apocrypha. These are Christian writings that date from, you know, the first century and second centuries, that were part of groups, sects of Christians that became heretical. You know, the orthodoxy that got established with the help of the Roman Empire,
yeah,
in after Constantine, hunted down these, you know, heretical apostate groups. You know, of course, you know, these other groups, you know, the Gnostics and the other folks there, the Manichaeans and what have you, thought that the orthodoxy was heretical, but the orthodoxy had the power. But it's interesting to read some of these other ancient scriptures of Jesus and see what they have to say, because you know, you do get a lot of ideas that are in conflict with what you read in the canonical Gospels,
yeah. Yeah.
The New Testament scriptures, and a much interesting and very different characterization of Jesus that you get in the Bible. So the fact that the Bible itself has all sorts of things that, that contradict, yeah, and conflict with one another shouldn't be surprising when you realize that, you know, for until about the year 150, Christianity as a whole had not really established its orthodoxy yet.
Yeah, yeah.
So there were all kinds of different Christian groups who had this, that, or the other idea about Jesus,
yeah,
and what Jesus' teachings were, and about what God was all about, and this, and how one should be Christian.
They all wrote down their own little thing.
Yeah. So going to read a bit more on that, and maybe we'll devote a show to that as soon as I've done some more, because it's just it's fascinating, the early history of Christianity that, yeah, I think a lot of contemporary Christians, modern-day Christians, don't know much about.
Yeah.
Suddenly, the phones are alive. Everybody must have come home from the swimming pool or something on this. So, okay, half hour to go, and we're just going to go right down the list. Susan is on one. Hi.
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 How you doing?
I'm doing fine. How are you?
We are well.
Well, good. I just have a question. I just tuned in. I don't know if you guys have talked about this, but on the news this past week, I saw Pat Robertson wanting his flock to pray for Supreme Court justices to retire.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I just found that fascinating. I wonder if you guys, obviously you've heard about it, what you're talking
about. We had a big giggle about it earlier in the show. It's interesting how, you know, as I pointed out, Pat said, one is in his 80s, and another one, like Ruth Bader Ginsburg, had cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And
another
one is supposedly has heart condition, although we haven't been able to pin down who that is. But I was thinking, you know, Pat Robertson is 73, and earlier this year, he was diagnosed with colon cancer and treated for it.
He should resign from his position.
Why isn't that a sign from God to resign, Pat? You know, so he's a little bit selective with his signs from God, isn't he?
Exactly.
Well, you see, God made that, or did he actually, was it cured?
He was selective.
Okay, so you see, God fixed it.
Well, but so Ruth Bader
Ginsburg says go on.
Yeah.
Now these other people already have their sicknesses.
No, but
Ginsburg is saying God should make them worse.
Well, they make them worse because they don't believe in godly principles.
Exactly.
Yes,
exactly. Everybody starts off with a baseline disease.
Mm-hmm.
If you go up from there, then that's approval by God. If you go down, then that's disapproval.
I just found that whole thing fascinating. You know, that he would make, you know, be praying basically. Praying for people to get sick.
Yeah.
That doesn't sound very Christian to me.
Yeah.
Well, you know,
yeah, because
he's
trying to spin it another way. But,
yeah. Well, you know, Pat Robertson, it's a lot like our old pal, the Apostle Paul, right? Christianity is the path to power for him. It's all about political, wielding that sort of political influence, which is really what he's been all about. You know, he's a strong social conservative with a very strong agenda to that regard, and his whole life has been devoted to this whole Christianizing, theocratizing of America, and this is just the next bit of babble,
you know, towards that agenda. Of course, we love it here, right? We love it every time. Pat can always be counted on to open his mouth and say something completely ridiculous anytime anything happens in this country that he doesn't approve of. And it's fun. I mean, when, Orlando, the city of Orlando hosted, a big gay pride festival.
Yeah.
And he promptly told the state of Florida that you better not do this, otherwise you're going to get a hurricane, a tornado, probably a meteor, a volcano eruption, even though there's no volcanoes down there. Aliens are probably going to land. And what else? I mean, just all sorts of tragedy and disaster was going to, you can always count on Pat to just say something wonderfully funny and provide all kinds of entertainment on the news. So,
yeah, well, thank you for your thoughts on
thank
that.
You okay. Very much.
Thanks
Susan.
For calling.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm going to do that. Like I said, I swear, atheists for Pat.
Yeah.
Just, we love Pat. You know, go Pat, say more funny things. He's just a veritable mine of quotes. What has Pat said? I have some stuff back here.
You have quotes from him too?
Looky Lou.
Ah, there we go.
I have 10 pages of quotes. I won't read. We actually have callers on the line right now, so I won't read to them all. But, this was Pat's opinion on September 11th. This is God's power, and he sent this thing to warn us. We needed a shock. So there's a big ringing endorsement of September 11th from Pat Robertson. God did this, so get ready for more, because we had it coming. Just amazing. He has all kind of stuff on like feminist agendas and witches and Satanists and homosexuals. Oh my! here it is. Yeah, I would warn Orlando. This was in 1998. I would warn Orlando, Florida, that you're right in the way of some serious hurricanes, and I don't think I'd be waving those flags in God's face if I were you. Now, of course, after this prayer of last week, right, when Pat came out and said, praying for, like, God to do send some kind of sign, the Supreme Court justices and this horrible, ruling that they gave, striking down the sodomy law in Texas, what then happened? This big hurricane slams into Texas, right?
Yeah.
So how are you going to interpret that? Either God is punishing Texas for ever having that stupid law to begin with.
Yeah.
Or maybe God is now punishing Texas for having it struck down, but it makes no sense for him to send the hurricane to Texas. Why not send it to the Supreme Court building?
Where it was turned down.
Yeah. Well, why not just give, Ginsburg more, give everybody heart attacks, which is what...
It goes back to the story that I had a week or two ago, which said God is unleashing all these tornadoes and hurricanes on the world when things happen that he's he just has bad aim. He meant to go for the Supreme Court.
Yeah, that's it.
Oops, hit Texas. Who can blame him?
Yeah, like something happens overseas that God supposedly doesn't like, and he hits Oklahoma with a tornado.
Exactly.
It's like, okay. It's one of these cryptic signs that it takes someone with the inside of Pat Robertson to interpret correctly.
It's actually Elohim on his different planet out somewhere.
And he's got bad aim. He's like Marvin the Martian.
The Earth. That's pretty good.
He's Marvin the Martian with his big gun, right? But he has Mars.
Yeah,
it's obstructing my view. And Bugs Bunny is up there messing with him, so he can't aim properly, so his big tornado gun is gone. That's it. Ah, boy. Okay. Well, maybe Carlos knows what this is. Has something intelligent to say to us goofballs. Anyway. Hey, you're on the air.
Hey, first a comment, then a question.
Sure.
Great show as usual.
Thank you.
But that's not the comment. I was just thinking that you guys should put out a greatest hits video or DVD, because over the years there have been some classics. And
we've thought of that, yeah.
I would buy it. I mean,
Well, thank you.
It would be great.
We'll get right on that. I'm getting my old video editing suite I'm setting up, so, that could be something to look forward to.
Oh, it'd be fun. It'd be a lot of fun. And the farther back, the more outrageous.
Yeah.
And along that line, I was curious, you used to do the fire and brimstone predictions, and you would debunk...
That was Jeff D's thing. When he was host, every week he would do the Rapture Report.
Yeah.
Well, the thing is, Rapture Reports did kind of trickle and dry out after the year 2000 came and went and the world forgot to end.
Yeah.
So we don't get too many of those predictions anymore. And after a while, after about doing it for about a year, the point was made, right? And all these folks telling you that the world is going to end, so you better, get right with God or come to my church or buy my book or do this or they're all pretty much full of it. And
Where are they now?
It was great. There's a website, and I forget, one of these alien cults. Darn it, I forget who they were, but. On their website, they had this thing talking about when the spaceships are going to come and take us all away to the happy place. And it said something in the website, the first sentence on the website, it said something like, in the very near future, the great diaspora, whatever they call it, would be da-da-da. And
But what's interesting was that was changed, because if you went to Google, right, and looked at the cached page that they had stored from the previous version, it would
on July 22nd.
It said, like, in this year of 2000. Okay, so they had a specific date.
Yeah.
And then the date came and went. And so they were like, and change it. No one will notice. Like the Seventh-day Adventist, right? Like every time the world didn't end, you know, the guy kept pushing it back.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's a blast.
What was that one lady that had predictions going on, and she had like 10 of them. And
Marilyn Agee.
Was a specific date, and as that date came when, she goes, oh, darn, it wasn't May 22nd. It's June 3rd! Watch out!
Yeah, you know, it's there are people exactly that gullible. They'll just, you know, there's always a market for that kind of thing.
Yeah, they make it fun, that's for sure.
And they do, yeah. Yeah, like I said, I was talking about earlier with Pat. If he didn't exist, we'd have to invent him.
Mm-hmm.
Tell ya.
Well, thanks, guys.
We appreciate you watching the show, and, stay in touch.
Will do. Right.
Hey. Sarah is on line 3. Let's see what she has to say. Hi, Sarah. You're on the air.
Hi, guys. Great show.
Thank you.
I'm having a good laugh today about the whole Pat Robertson thing. He's a kook.
Yes, for Pat.
You know, I was thinking, since he is anti-choice, probably one of the big reasons he's praying for one of the Supreme Court justices to die is, so the Roe versus Wade will be overturned. That's probably the main reason, I would think.
Well, yeah,
that's,
if you pack the,
part of it, yeah.
You know, if a bunch of Bush appointees get into the, he packs it full of arch conservatives.
Yeah, he even said in the interview that, 43 million babies have been slaughtered since Roe v. Wade, and he goes on about it. So.
Stuff like
I guess
that.
They just forget about the ones in daycare, or not in daycare, but in like orphanages and
yeah. After you're born, they don't want to know about you. They don't care anymore. Mm-hmm. Here we go.
What about all the natural abortions that God does?
Yeah, you mean like all those instances where the ovum doesn't attach to the uterine wall, and it gets sort of like. Yeah, you need to have a word with God about all those natural abortions that he performs. And that is part of course, that's what Pat wants. He wants, a Christian America. He wants arch-conservatives in the courts. He wants, all us, nasty progressives and atheists and unbelievers to go far away. Where we can't always have a good laugh at the stuff he says on TV.
I also had a comment about the priest who, I guess, was talking just saying horrible things about that guy. I guess in our culture, or in most cultures, when you have a funeral, you're supposed to, tone down the bad things about the person. That's like for drunk Uncle Ed to say, when you go home after the funeral and everything, but. When you're a priest or when you're someone in that position, you're supposed to be there to comfort people.
Yeah.
And just to have somebody say that, that's just really, that's pretty horrible.
Yeah.
It's no...
So I was wondering if he owed this guy money or something or what have you, but
it was fairly graphic. It wasn't just, I had my misgivings about him, had my questions.
He wasn't a perfect person, but
saying God vomits him into hell.
God, that's like
horrible. That's not gray area there.
Tact, diplomacy, not a strong point of this man, clearly.
So,
I guess he figured, things can't get worse for the Catholic priesthood in this country, so I'm just going to go all out.
Going to go down in a ball of flame.
Yeah. It's like more and more. Well, we appreciate you watching the show, Sarah. That's great.
Thank you very
Anything
much.
Anything else? All right. Well, stay in touch, okay?
Thanks for calling.
All right. Okay. Oh, Sam is on one. Let's see what Sam has to say. Hi, you're on TV.
Thank you very much. I didn't think I could actually get through today.
It was a little slow. Maybe everyone's out at Burton Springs or swimming or enjoying the nice heat. So
actually, I'm here in Salt Lake using my Utah cell phone.
Oh, goodness. Okay.
Wow. Okay.
The question I've got for you, having been around Mormons for so many years, are you aware of any studies which would indicate that they may be genetically inferior?
Mormons?
Yes.
Oh, wow. I doubt that that's the case.
That's a new one on me.
Yeah, I would not go so far. Even I would not say that about the Mormons. I mean,
would. I did have one criticism for you.
Okay.
It's regarding some of the comments made about the Catholic Church. I think you've overlooked one really positive thing that they do.
Okay.
Whether you know this or not, they require all that their pedophiles wear a white collar. And I think you maybe should be a little more positive about that.
You're right. I think that's very
good point.
Thanks, very
guys.
Responsible. Hey, thank you.
You did a great job.
We appreciate it. Hey. That's funny. Krakauer's book is out, the Under the Banner of Heaven, which the Mormons are livid about. Yeah, and I've seen it. I haven't picked it up yet, but I hope to do that this week, where he talks about the polygamy thing, which the Latter-day Saints Church, the Mormon Church, has long since outlawed. But there are these little breakaway guys who are like, no, that's apostasy, and we should go back to the original.
Yeah.
And it's this whole... And he talks about, my goodness. I'm just so, it's just belching forth from the attitude of the whole belief system setting up this situation in which these two men could brutalize and I think murder this one woman, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And he doesn't, as I understand from just what I've read in the book in terms of reviews, he does like take the Mormon Church to task for like creating this environment and saying this is the danger of these kinds of irrational beliefs. So I'm looking very much forward to reading the book. Now, I don't know if it is possible that I wouldn't, again, genetically inferior, let's not go there, but if you are practicing polygamy and you're like marrying and impregnating your own daughters and cousins and stuff, you could have some genetic, there's a powder keg there waiting to explode genetically for sure, seems like. So we got 15 minutes left in the show, so get those calls in, 477-2288. There's a number. Don't forget, tv@atheist-experience.org is the viewer email feedback address, too.
Atheist-community.
Is that what, did I? Oh, no.
tv@atheist-community.org.
Community.org. I said experience, didn't I?
Yeah.
I am just,
We are the Atheist Experience, hosted by the Atheist Community.
There we are. So. That we are. That's who we are. And we're proud of it. tv@atheist-community.org. John is on the phone. Hi, you're on TV?
Yes, I would like to comment about the physician-assisted suicide.
Yes.
I think that it should be instituted here in the United States. I know someone called a couple of weeks ago about it, and I very much agree. I think that most of the, it's in Holland. I don't know about Sweden, but I do know it's in Holland, and it's in the state of Oregon, and I'm sorry that the Bush administration is trying to strike it down with all their other problems with the war, and they seem to be concentrating on this and trying to overturn Oregon, which is the only state that allows physician-assisted suicide, people to die with dignity. They are doing their best to overturn it and putting pressure on Oregon politicians. The Democratic and Republican senator from Oregon have come under quite a bit of fire from, caught a bit of lobbyists from, the Bush administration to overturn it. And that's my only comment. I think that they should have it and everything. I think there's people that are in terminally shape and agree to it. They have a terminal illness that is very advanced. I believe they have a right to choose for themselves. They want to die with dignity. It's just the wrong thing for the Attorney General Ashcroft to concentrate on at this time.
Okay. Yeah. Well, we appreciate your input there.
Thank you.
Sean. Yeah, it is one of those things that there are some problems with it that can definitely be worked out. I mean, it's something that you certainly don't want, family members taking advantage of.
Well, I have
a financial burden on the family or something like that.
Yeah, I have heard that argument being made, that it is a thing that could possibly be misused in such a way to where it becomes like, the final solution, right? Or something where we're just getting rid of all the undesirables.
Yeah.
Well, no, it's like, first off, it would have to be an individual consent thing. And I think that nobody but, the person who is going to be the suicidee, as it were, should, be in any way legally allowed. There could never be a situation where, somebody's relative turned up and said, our incredibly massively rich uncle, who's really, really sick,
depending on what condition he's in, I mean, it's possible that you could,
And he's delusional,
already in a bad situation. Yeah. You could convince him that,
He's delusional, so he doesn't know what's in. He's going to say he doesn't want to die, but he really does. It's not going to be like this Monty Python, bring out your dead thing. It's like, I'm not dead! I don't think there's really that risk.
But that's, you know, the critics of the whole physician-assisted suicide, they kind of bring that up, that you're going to get that whole, you know.
It's not necessarily a reason to stop it all from happening, period. But it's definitely something to keep an eye open for and be really careful, because that's not something you can undo. So.
Well, sure. Yeah. I mean, there would have to be, I think, a big battery of, you know,
psychological tests. And everything.
I mean, because you could, if someone, for example, is clinically depressed.
Yeah.
You know, and they may have terminal cancer.
Yeah.
But the terminal cancer could, you know, at least maybe be held at bay to where they might be able, with right treatment, they could still have a good five or few productive years. But if they're saying, I want to die now, and it's like, you know, is it because they're ill and they are terminally depressed on clinically, not terminally depressed, boy, that'd be real bad, but clinically depressed on because of the illness, and therefore they might not be thinking completely rationally about the situation.
Yeah.
And you could get one diagnosis from a doctor, I mean, who says you're terminal here, and then two other guys, you get a second opinion, and he says, well, no, actually, we can treat this. There are cases where people thought you've got like a 3% chance of living, and it goes into remission, and you're fine.
Yeah.
So it should be a definitely difficult thing. But in principle, I agree with the whole idea that you should be the master of your own life and that and the other. But obviously, there are, you know, there's
things to watch out
room for. Liz, on line two. Hi.
Hi. Last week you guys were talking about a Jehovah's Witness who, her family wouldn't let her get a blood transfusion.
Yes.
Yes.
And evidently not only will they not let their daughters get blood transfusion, they also will not let their dogs have a blood transfusion.
Wow. Yeah.
Okay.
You know why? Because the scripture that they use for the justification for that doctrine has to do with animal sacrifices.
Yeah.
So it has to, and you know, and where it is something about not, I'll look it up, in fact. I'll go and I'll get the exact scripture, but it has to do with, you know, not taking the blood of something else into you and this, that, and the other.
Yeah.
And so I guess,
it's just taken to an extreme.
Yeah, interesting.
I just feel bad for the dog, because it's not like he, like, you know, worships Jehovah or anything.
I know. It's like,
he doesn't have a spot reserved in heaven for him.
Yeah. So okay. Sorry about that, Liz. Well, thanks for your call anyway. They kind of went out of it there. Oh, is this the same Sarah who we had already? She's back. Hi.
Hi there. Yeah, it is me. I just had a question.
Cool.
I was wondering what you guys thought, if there's at any point in a person's life that spirituality could be a positive thing, like meditation to relieve stress, or, you know, things like that, like living the Buddhist way or something like that. Just a spiritual type of living that doesn't take over your life, you know, where you're not judging other people and, you know, you don't necessarily believe in heaven and hell and things like that, but at what point could it be healthy for someone to believe in, you know, a few superstitious things and of various nature?
Do you want to start? Or?
I definitely think that there can be room for that. You know, it can be something because, Western culture doesn't have it all. Eastern culture doesn't have it all. There's always going to be areas where your life can be improved. And meditation, you know, it does have benefits. Now, you know, you may not be able to float and fly like some of them say, you know.
Yeah.
There are limitations.
Can't be delusional about it.
Exactly. You know, just keep yourself strapped to the earth. But yeah, I mean, there definitely are benefits to things like that, getting your clear thought, getting relaxed and, you know, ready to take on the world for another day, rather than just constantly being bogged down by...
We've talked about this before on just the nature of spiritualism before. Yeah. We've had calls about this. And I've said many times that whenever I hear, like, someone who's a believer, whenever I try to get a definition of what the word spiritual means to them, what significance that has, what I usually end up hearing is a description of some sort of experience that they have that is emotionally fulfilling at a very deep level. And in many cases, it's emotionally fulfilling in a way that sometimes, like, reinforces maybe a belief system that they've already had, something that they've grown up with. But in any case, what I do hear is, like, it has to do with achieving some sense of tranquility and a feeling of rightness.
Or about, wholeness, maybe.
Yeah, your life.
Alone in the world.
Yeah. And, you know, that is not a thing that a secular person cannot experience. And, you know, sometimes for me, it's just... You know, sitting down, you know, with my favorite CD on, or after having a really yummy meal, or I just go outside if it's a beautiful day and just soak up the day. And, you know, and I think it is necessary for your emotional health to have these moments of downtime where you're just with yourself and you're calm and you're just relieving the stress in whatever natural way you have. And that's fine. And if a person wants to call that spiritual, mm-hmm. like, you know, like when I hear word, you know, like phrases like triumph of the human spirit and the human spirit will prevail and all that. And what that's to me, that's like that sense of what, you know, that it's the self-esteem. It is, you know, your feeling of, you know, I can accomplish what I need to accomplish. I'm satisfied with where I am, even though there's good stuff and bad stuff. And that's fine. And that's fine. You know, but when I think it's unnecessary to attach, you know, unproven, superstitious beliefs to that in order to have that experience. I mean, I don't know that I need to think that I'm in touch with some sort of higher being or plane or other realm or my dead relatives or what have you to feel that. I think that's attaching a whole lot of baggage to it that actually holds you back, because the more you attach that to it, then you're adding something that could bring in some delusionment. Yeah. Disillusionment.
Like of Christianity, like if you don't believe this, you are going to burn.
Yeah.
How healthy is that?
Do you get a sense of tranquility out of the idea that, I better not slip up, because otherwise I'll fry. You know,
other friends and family, other people in the world are burning, but hey, at least I'm up here.
Yeah.
That feels good. Yeah.
Two-thirds of the world is doomed to hellfire, but I'm confident of my salvation, and I'm spiritually fulfilled. Yeah. No, that's arrogance.
Definitely.
So yeah. You know, last week I went for massage. A good friend of mine, his fiance is training as a massage therapist, and so I went to. She's trying to get all her friends to come in during her little internship period, so that she can get. So I went in. Right, it was great. Right, I hadn't had one done in like forever.
Yeah.
And boy, I needed it. But now she is. I don't know if she's atheist, but she's rational. She's not superstitious and doesn't, you know, adhere to any of this. You know, just the metaphysical kookiness that comes with this kind of thing every now and again.
Yeah.
But the place where she's training and took her lessons and everything is awash in this stuff.
New ageism and
exactly. Like I went into, you know, it's like the little room, you know, where there's the table in it, and she's showing me around. We're having a giggle over all of just the kooky stuff that's around there, like little crystals for crystal healing.
Yeah.
And there are these rows of bottles on this rack, right? Like little perfume bottles, okay, filled with all these colored liquids, and it's for color therapy. Apparently, you do something with this colored liquid, don't know what, don't particularly want to know what, but you do something with it, and it's the color that is somehow supposed to do something to you therapeutically.
I've heard of that. Red gives you energy.
Programming your mind. Look at the red bottle.
Yeah.
Now the blue.
And these bottles are like exorbitantly expensive, just like perfume, right? They're incredibly expensive, and what's interesting to me is...
Food dye.
You know, there is a point to where, you know, you're talking about people being spiritual and stuff, okay? And then you're talking about people being exploited.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying... I'm sure that the folks who are manufacturing and marketing this kind of stuff really do believe that it has these properties. Yeah. So I don't know that you could accurately accuse them of deliberate fraud, right? But the fact is, because these things like alternative medicines and all this stuff in, you know, the whole spiritual, the New Age community, as it were...
Yeah.
Is not regulated, right? The whole alternative medicine supplements, that whole business, it's like $1 billion or so a year business.
Yeah.
And it's completely unregulated.
Yeah.
Okay, so it is perfectly possible for people to be out there selling all of these tinctures and these homeopathic this and the color therapy that.
Any kind of plant that they dug up from their backyard.
And sell it to you for like $50 a pop and not be prosecuted for fraud if it doesn't happen to do anything. Because if you like rub it on you and it does nothing, then they can say, oh, well, you know, you weren't properly in tuned with your energies, and that's
why it might have more of a placebo effect, I guess.
Yes.
Yeah, it could. But it's just amazing to me. But, you know, it's just it's like I went and I got that massage and I felt like totally awesome. And I didn't need to think that, boy, you know, I got my energies in line.
Yeah.
You know, that wasn't what it was all about. It's like I had a sore back and it got taken care of. So, but like, hey, thanks for calling, Sarah. We are done for today.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching. Well, there's another show. Kind of a slow, very mellow, laid-back Sunday. But a nice show overall, I thought.
Yes.
I enjoyed doing it.
Very much so.
Go ahead.
As always.
Well, we are here
every Sunday, 4:30, and reruns are on Tuesdays at 4:30. And so tune in again, call us up, yell at us, send us an inflammatory email, and we'll do that. TV@atheist-community.org. Here's a bunch of other cool websites if you want to know stuff about stuff, Skeptics Dictionary, all that kind of thing. Thank you to our valiant crew who is always there to help us out every Sunday. And I do believe that's about it. So, Atheist for Pat. I think I'm going to, I'll put some feelers out and see what
Any atheists out there who agree with it, come down to the bagel shop.
Our pal, Pat.
Toss around ideas.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, here comes Pat. It's time. We're done for today. Theists, we don't hate you. We just think you're wrong. Especially Pat. Thanks for watching. We love you, Austin. There go our love eyes out to Austin. Bye-bye.